Very good. So let me start with saying thank you to all organizers for organizing such an interesting meeting. And today we'll talk about my paper, which I wrote last year during lockdown. And the subject of my talk is quantum gravity, randomization group equation, and relations, recurrence relations for poles. Here is outline of my talk. I will start with motivations. Then I will discuss Toft's randomization group equations and introduce randomization group equations for metric. I will discuss high curvature couplings, and then I will try to solve, randomization group equations, and we'll make some general observations and statements. So the motivation from this study is the following. Thinking about quantum gravity, we usually think in terms of one loop or two loop computations, but maybe it's worth thinking about quantum gravity in terms of entire perturbation series. And thinking that way, we will have to take into account certain relations which exist between terms in the series. In my talk, I will be using dimensional regularization. So my perturbation action, quantum action will be decomposed in series with respect to 1 over d minus 4. And there will be single poles, which just 1 over d minus 4, and higher poles, 1 over d minus 4 to some power n, and n is larger than 1. So the main subject in my talk will be to find relations between single pole and higher poles. Then I will be interested in the following question. I want to know how the poles, these higher poles, vanish on shell. By on shell, I mean the condition when Ricci tensor is zero. So it is indeed on shell for classical gravity. And what is the complete perturbation theory and what is the appropriate low energy theory? Before I start, I would like to make three remarks. First of all, there is a parallel activity initiated by Dima Kazakov to make sense of non-normalizable theories. And his idea was to make non-normalizable theories as much as possible close to renormalizable, generalized randomization group equations, and so on. Dima Kazakov gave a nice talk last week on a previous workshop. I guess it's possible to, if somebody missed his talk, to see video. This activity is not directly related to what I will be doing, except for this first paper Kazakov wrote in 1988, where he proposed general sort of approach to non-normalizable theories. And in fact, what I will be talking today is a result of my attempt to understand his paper. The second remark, I will consider only pure quantum gravity. So lambda cosmological constant is zero, and I will not include any matter. And the last remark, if you talk about quadratic gravity, so we include r squared, r plus r squared on the classical level. This theory has a modified propagator. It has a ghost, it is renormalizable. And the normalization of metric is multiplicative. One can also introduce in this theory relation between this recurrence relation for poles. And it was discussed in these papers by Kalmykov and possibly others. And from my point of view, this theory belongs to completely different class of theories, different from quantum general relativity, and it will not be considered in my talk. So I will use Toft's approach to Ramezeshi group. It was introduced by Toft in 1973 in a paper in Nuclear Physics. And it can be explained very well in a few seconds. Let us consider a theory with renormalizable theory with a coupling constant, which is dimensionless. And in perturbation theory, it receives certain corrections and renormalization. So in general, we have a series of terms like that. So epsilon is still d minus 4. A1 would be a residue at the single pole, and k greater than 1 would be higher poles. So lambda r is renormalized value of renormalized coupling constant would be dimensionless. Lambda b constant would have some dimension. That's why we introduce mu. And derivatives of lambda r would give us beta. And beta is a beta function for lambda. So now Bayer constant is not supposed to depend on mu. Taking derivative with respect to mu, we get certain equations. And we can see now, we can now analyze these equations as a series in epsilon. So the term linear in epsilon cancels here automatically. The constant term would give us a relation between beta function I introduced here and the A1. So A1 is the single pole. So single pole determines beta function. And higher for k, well, 1 over epsilon to some power k, k is larger or equal to 1, give us certain relations between the poles which appear in this expansion for lambda. So basically, it is a recurrence relation, provided we know coefficient ak, we can enter, compute coefficient ak plus one. And a prime here is the derivative of a with respect to lambda, with respect to coupling constant. This is can be generalized completely to include renormalization of fields, quantum fields of mass. In the case of renormalizable theory, renormalization of field, quantum field is multiplicative, it's just multiplication of area of the field by epsilon dependent factor. But it shouldn't be necessarily that way. It can be a general renormalization, general type of renormalization. In fact, in Toft's paper, that kind of generalization was already included in the consideration. And and if you're talking about renormalizable theory, then all quantum action can be, well, which is initial action plus ultraviolet division terms, epsilon dependent terms, can be, all these divergences can be hidden in a renormalization of this lambda phi and m in the bare quantum action. So now the idea is to generalize this Toft's renormalization group approach to quantum gravity. And important point here, that we need to renormalize metric. normalized metric. So metric here is a quantum field, sort of quantum field, and we have to introduce a general type of normalization of metric. This metric normalization is not multiplicative because theory is not normalizing. And in fact, this idea was on the surface already since the paper of Toft and Weltmann, who noticed that one loop divergences, which are quadratic in a Ricci scalar and a Ricci tensor, can be removed if we do a filter definition, so to normalization of metric of this way. And in fact, more generally, many people noticed after that that any term of that type, so it's integral of contraction of Einstein tensor with some other tensor, if there is such a term in the divergent term, it can be removed by filter definition. But the question, how do it consistently? Because while this normalization works, because we take a classical Einstein Hilbert action, take variation, and give us Einstein tensor times variation of metric. And for variation metric, we put this term over there, and we get something which looks like one loop ultraviolet diffusion term, and that's why we can arrange the constellation. But what happens if you do compute second variation of Einstein-Hilbert action, third variation, or if we compute take into account variation corresponding variation of the contour terms, and so on, so on. So clearly, we need here some kind of order, which is usually made by normalization group. So that's why we need a normalization group. So the idea is to introduce a normalization of the metric. I will consider, so we go just outside, we change value of dimension, slightly different from four, but I will keep dimensionality of Newton constant to be equal to two. Still same dimensionality as in four dimensions. So in this case, a renormalized metric is dimensionless, but bare metric has received some dimensionality, which is compensated. Well, that's why we need to introduce mu. And here we take a general expansion in powers one over epsilon with local, so hk is a local function of renormalized metric, local covariant function. We introduce a beta function for the metric. And in fact, if you look at these two equations, well, people familiar with string theory or sigma models immediately recognize that it is exactly those equations which appear in two-dimensional sigma models for the target metric. The important difference, however, is that here, well, in the case of sigma model, target metric represents infinite number of coprints, while in our case, it would represent just a filter renormalization. So again, we take a derivative with respect to mu of bare metric and get certain equations similar to what we had before for coupling lambda. And again, well, we have to look at certain terms, fixed power of epsilon in this equation and see what happens. So a linear term in epsilon cancels automatically. Zero order of epsilon, so it's constant term, give us a relation between beta function and H1. H1 is coefficient in the single pole. And again, if you look at higher power of epsilon, we get a relation, a recurrence relation between hk plus one and hk. Again, people familiar with sigma model immediately recognize that exactly same equations appear in string theory. And in fact, they play important role in string theory as well in sigma models as consistency condition for higher loop calculations. And we see that, as always, the complete information is contained in a single pole. So provided single pole is known, we can compute beta function and then compute all higher poles. In our case, we have to expand in power. We have a perturbation expansion in powers of Newton constant. So both coefficients HK and beta function should be expanded in powers of Newton constant. So L here represents is some parameter which counts loops, number of loops. And coefficients here, H, which we, now we have two indices, K and L. L represents the loop order, and K represents the certain coefficient in the, well, it represents the poles in the expansion with respect to epsilon. So k equal L would correspond to highest pole, and k equal one would correspond to single pole. And well, in this case, equations which I had before can be solved completely, and beta L would be directly related to H1L. And recurrence relation give us a relation between this coefficient HK plus one L and lower order coefficients in the expansion. So this is first set of RG equations that we will deal with, but we need one more modification, which deviates, of course, from what we had in our consideration from what we had in the case of string theory, well, sigma models. We have to modify gravitational action because our theory is not normalizable. We anticipate that we will need certain high curvature terms to absorb certain divergences. And that's why, so L0 is my classical action, just integral of R, U sine minus. And WL is a polynomial of degree L plus one constructed from a Riemann tensor. So I include here only terms which can be constructed from the Riemann tensor. The certain coupling lambda L. And just for convenience, I express lambda L in terms of Newton constant times some dimensionless coupling lambda L, little lambda L. In L equal one, so if L equal one, due to Gauss-Bonnet identity, we don't have any independent term to be added here, which depends only on Riemann tensor. In L equal two, we have one such tensor, such contraction of three tensors, three Riemann tensors.
Sergei, I have a question. So you are on shell, Ricci is zero.
No, I'm not on shell, no. I'm considering general.
Why don't you have independent invariance in L equal one case? You have Ricci squared and Riemann squared.
No, no, it's because Gauss-Bonnet. So Riemann squared, in principle, we have Riemann squared. But Riemann squared can be expressed as Ricci squared plus Ricci scalar squared plus Euler number.
But still, there are two invariants.
Well, if you count Euler number, then yes. But I'm working, say, in a trivial topology. So I don't take into account Euler number.
Just a moment. You have curvature scalar squared and Weyl squared terms. Two.
Right. But my PL is invariant constructed only from Riemann tensor.
So you exclude.
I exclude already on this point all Ricci dependent terms in the section.
In this sense, you are kind of on shell that you put all.
No, I'm not kind of shell. I'm off shell.
Okay, so still you include only you do not include powers of Ricci here.
I don't include powers of Ricci because, after all, they will disappear completely after I use, as soon as I use filter renormalization.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
We're interrupting you.
Okay. Sorry. So when L is greater than 2, there would be more, of course, invariants, which can be constructed from the Riemann tensor. And I would assume that mathematicians would probably know how many such invariants in general. But my discussions with mathematicians didn't reveal any sort of existence of classification theorem. So if there is such a classification theorem for possible invariants of high order, it's probably quite well hidden from physicists. But I don't need this exact explicit expression for this invariants. Next point is that as soon as I added this high curvature couplings, high curvature terms in the action, these terms will produce new Gill-Modified Feynman diagrams. Indeed, if I expand such a term of order L over Minkowski background, I will see terms of it. The first to the leading order, phi is a small pair perturbation over Minkowski. I will see such a term, which of order L plus one in terms of phi. So it doesn't modify propagator, but it gives us new vertex, which we have to take into account, respective coupling lambda L. The important point here is to notice that if you fix a certain degree of polynomial, curvature polynomial in the action, and see what kind of terms in my initial gravitational action would contribute to divergences proportional to this term. It's important to note that not all lambdas will contribute. So clearly, if P is sufficiently large, it will not contribute to invariant of order L, which is smaller than P. But in general, there is a more restrictive constraint, which I wrote here. So sum of P's should be less than L minus one. In particular, this means that let's look at quantities which may appear in three loops and how they, divergent counterterms which may appear in three loops and how they may depend on lambda 2 And lambda 2 is the coefficient in front of coupling constant in front of cubic Riemann term. This constraint mean tell us that it may appear only linearly. So there's no quadratic term or higher order term. It may appear only as a linear function. So now we can formulate all our equations. First of all, we have higher curvature couplings for which we write down normalization equations, similar to what Toft taught us to do in normalizable theories. I'm sorry. Then we have normalization of metric. And now I have to modify the equations which I had before, because now my coefficients may depend not only on the metric, normalized metric, but also on the couplings, on this high curvature couplings. So that's why I have this extra terms in my equations. And finally, quantum action. So I have my initial gravitational action plus contour terms which appear. It's a priori it's infinite series in 1 over epsilon to some power k. And the contour terms which appear here, I will separate on two different classes. LK represent contour terms which vanish on shell. So they contain at least one power of Ricci tensor, or at least one power of Einstein tensor. And VK, V are contour terms which do not vanish if Ricci is zero. And they are determined, they are constructed only from Riemann tensor. And I should say that, well, so V is proportional to P. P is this invariance, set of invariants I can construct from Riemann tensor. And in two loops, so it's correspond to V12, was computed by Gorov and Sanyuti in 1986. And later this result was confirmed by Anton van de Ven in 1992. So now this is my quantum action. Take a derivative with respect to mu. I end up with certain equation which looks complicated. In fact, this sort of equation already appeared in Kazakov's 1998 paper, but he didn't include any filter normalization. And I think it's important to include this ingredient in the consideration. So I introduce here lambda, well, this dot product is basically a contraction of variation of L with beta, and we take an integral. So if L is zero, for L zero, this variation would give us Einstein tensor. So now idea is to solve this normalization group equations. And basic data, as always, is contained in the single pole terms. So this L1L and V1L. At order epsilon to zero, we have this equation, which can be used to determine the beta functions for high curvature couplings and for the metric. And at order 1 over epsilon to some power k, which is k is larger or equal to 1, we get equation, which is a recurrence equation for the higher poles. Well, the way I introduced this series, I considered first series in terms of epsilon, and then each term expanded in powers of a Newton constant, I can exchange the order of these two sums. First sum over epsilon, well, just take a sum with respect to power of Newton constant. This is basically a loop order. And for which loop order I have a sum for poles of 1 over a, epsilon. And here, if I fix L, the loop order, I have k equal 1. K equal 1 corresponds to single pole, and k equal L corresponds to highest pole. And there are some intermediate poles. So let's try to solve these equations. First, we look at the equation for the beta function. And let's take L equal 1. It's simplest equation we have. And it's written here. So V11 doesn't appear because, as we discussed, it automatically vanishes. This is from quadratic in Riemann. So now L11 is what we have in one loop. Generically, it's quadratic in Einstein tensor. And it can be written this way. It's Einstein tensor contracted with some tensor X1. X1 has this form. So basically, this first equation can be written like that. And we immediately solve this equation, express beta function is X1. X1 appears here. This is so up to usual ambiguity. You can always add to a beta function some combination of nabla acting on vector field symmetrized. So now L equal 2, similar equation, but now appears a new term, P2. P2 is a cubic term in Riemann tensor. So now we have three terms. First term vanishes on shell. Second term vanishes on shell. Third term doesn't vanish on shell. So it should coefficient in front of this term should vanish by itself. And let give us a beta function for the Kalpin, high curvature Kalpin. And the rest equation, so basically the sum of these two terms should be zero. In the similar way as before, give us expression for the beta function in two loops. And well, it depends, of course, on the X2, which appears in the two loop contour term, which vanishes in shell. And there it may appear a term which is quadratic in Riemann tensor. So that X2 doesn't necessarily vanish on shell. It may contain a Riemann square term. In fact, Gorov and Sagnotti found that C0 is non-zero. So already in two loops, a beta function would not be vanishing on shell. So now we go to third loop, L equal 3. We have more terms appear in this case. So first two terms vanish on shell. Third that doesn't vanish on shell. Fourth term vanishes on shell because beta one vanishes. This term vanishes on shell and P3 doesn't. So the terms which do not vanish on shell, coefficient in front of them should vanish on shell, should be zero. And let give us a beta function for lambda 3 for the high curvature Kalpin, which stands in front of quartic in Riemann tensor. And then the rest of this equation give us beta function for metric in three loops. Now we have, remember we had the equations for beta function, the equations for these recurrence equations. So let's look at these recurrence equations for higher poles. So if L equal one, no higher poles, so this equation is just trivial. L equal two, we have this equation. So again, L is vanishing on shell. Beta one vanishes on shell. So this right hand side of this equation vanishes on shell. V two two is the only term which is proportional to Riemann tensor. Fourth power of Riemann tensor, or third power of Riemann tensor. That's why coefficient in front of this term should vanish on shell, should vanish automatically. So V to two is should be zero. And this in fact agrees with the result, two loop result, which was obtained long time ago by Chase in 1982. And he was using completely different arguments for this result. And the rest of this equation give us L to two. Now we go to L equal three. So it's three loop. Now we have two equations here for K equal one, for K equal two. And each term should be understood as expansion in, well, it's a linear function of lambda two. We solve these two equations together, and this is the result. So first of all, we notice that again, V33, the highest pole should vanishes automatically. So there is no Riemann tensor in the highest pole. In the highest pole, the term which vanishes on shell vanishes on shell quadratically. So it's proportional to Newton constant, Einstein tensor squared. And the other observation that none of these terms depend on lambda two. So even though the single pole may be linear function of lambda two doesn't appear in the higher poles. We can continue, well, this analysis, but it's simpler to look at what I call GR counter terms. GR counter terms is what we get from the counter terms if you take the limit of vanishing lambdas. So we take the counter terms, compute them for general, including five vertices produced by high curvature terms, and take the limit of Kauprin's to zero. This is basically counter terms which come only from Ricci's scalar. This equation is quite simple. So beta zero p is a metric beta function in the limit of lambdas when we take lambda to zero. And again, these equations can be analyzed, and there are, well, a few properties, general properties valid in any loop order. So first we observe that, so V correspond to these terms which are proportional to powers of Riemann tensor, and L, the counter terms which contain at least one power of Ricci tensor. So in the highest order, K equal L, the term Riemann tensor is zero. It doesn't appear. And the term which vanishes on shell should vanish quadratically. So it should be at least quadratic in Einstein tensor. So next to highest pole, it corresponds to L minus one. Again, similar property, there are no terms which are only due to Riemann tensor. And the terms which vanish on shell at least linearly in Einstein tensor. And starting with L equal four, so starting with four loops in the order K equal L minus 2. This is the order where Riemann tensor may start to appear. So in this case, in general, and this is because beta 2, which I discussed before, that doesn't vanish doesn't vanish on shell. And it makes appearance exactly at this order in this equation, in this equation. So let me make some remarks on previous works. Gorov and Sanyoti, 1986, not only computed the single pole divergences, but they also computed high pole counterterms, what I call A22 and V22. So V22 is zero, as it should be, but in A22, they find a term which is linear in Einstein tensor. So it's Einstein tensor contracted with product of two Riemann tensors. And according to this analysis, it shouldn't appear at this order in the highest pole. And the possible source of disagreement is that they overcount the possible independent curvature invariants. So when they do this Feynman diagram computation, very complicated, at the end, they expand the result in terms of 9 invariants. And that allows them to fix the coefficient in front of this invariants. But the important point to observe that in 4 dimensions, Riemann tensor contracted with 3 indices. So there are 2 indices, 3 indices, I and G. This identity, which relates this tensor, this contraction of 2 Riemann tensors with a contraction of 4 indices of Riemann tensor. That means that this E8 invariant is not independent. It's related to E7 and E4, E5, E6. So it should be excluded from the list. So it seems that if we do this, if we reduce the list of possible invariants and do the computation, it will change the coefficients, the results for higher poles and tools. And possibly it will modify the result for this term, which is linear in Einstein tensor. And as I discussed in the case of randomized theory, we can do the following. So we compute, we have our initial action plus counterterms, and all these ultraviolet divergent counterterms can be removed into renormalization of parameters, couplings, masses, and fields which appear in the Bay action. And it appears that similar can be proven in the case of quantum gravity. So basically, I have this my initial action, which is L0 is integral of Ricci scalar, W contains this series in the Riemann tensor plus the counterterms. And my this is my Bay action, and all these divergences can be completely hidden in the renormalization of these parameters in the Bay action. And what is important here, all terms which contain Ricci tensor, these ALK terms will disappear in this procedure. So I don't include any Ricci tensor in my W action, only Riemann tensor. So Riemann tensor is sufficient to renormalize all possible divergences. So you see, after I used renormalization for metric, this renormalization washed away all Ricci dependent terms in the quantum action. So some nodes and no richer tensor appears, as I already said. And if we look at the low energy action, we keep only one Lagrangian term, which is cubic in Riemann tensor. So no Ricci square term here. And as a remark, I would say that probably it's interesting to look at this action by, it might be interesting by itself to look at this action. If you expand it over Minkowski background, it doesn't modify propagator. It's still propagator, usual propagator, but it modifies the vertices, which may appear here, interaction. And since it is still a high curve, it contains high derivatives, this instability or non-unitarity may be hidden somewhere in this interaction. So my summary, we introduced a consistent set of normalization group equations for pure quantum gravity. We solved, well, at least to some order, these equations exactly. And we obtained that this, by the way, equations can be used, constraints can be used as a consistency condition for future higher loop computations. And of course, there are still open questions. We did our best to make our theory look like a normalizable theory, but still it has infinite number of terms. It has infinite number of couplings, and it still has the same thickness as usual. The other question is whether I can generalize this construction and for other normalizable theories. I don't see any abstractions. And there is a technical challenges. If you think about it, it's been like 35 years since Gorff and Sagnotti computed two loops, 47 years since one loop computation of Toft and Weltmann. And it's probably about time to do something in higher loops. There was some activity in higher loop computations in supergravity, but I'm not aware of any results in pure quantum gravity. It would be interesting to go beyond two loops. Thank you for your attention. Sasha.
Thank you, Sergei. And where is the question from Sergei Sibiryakov, please?
Hello, Sergei. Thank you for the nice talk.
Hi, so, Sergei.
So my question is, I'm wondering in which sense it's different from the usual like normalization group approach to effective theories, described in Weiberg's book. Is there any difference or just that?
Well, one difference I can see that there is no scale parameter here. So in Toft's approach, there is no scale. It is a expansion in d minus four. There is no scale.
That's right. But even if I have effective theory, for example, like in pi and physics, yeah. So there is a scale there, QCD scale or whatever. I mean that controls or rho mass scale that appears in the couplings. But then I can do a normalization using dimreg as here, and all my couplings will run. And people are doing that. I mean, they're studying coupling running of these dimensionful couplings, and that theory include that in their calculations. In this sense, what you are doing to me looks similar. You write down the most general action with dimensionful couplings, and then study its running.
Effectively, I replaced all dimensionful couplings with dimensionless, expressing them in terms of G Newton. But in a sense, yes, you are right. I don't think I'm doing something exotic here.
So in this sense, I think your question about consistency is kind of obviated. So it is consistent because you included everything.
No. I mean, yes, but Well, you know, the usual philosophy that if you have infinite number of couplings, you need infinite number of experiments to fix these couplings. And that's why this theory is not a good theory. I mean, this usual arguments against non-normalizable theories. So in this sense, it's still not consistent.
No, I think I should just use it at low energies and treat these ambiguities, like just arrange them as as powers of energy scale over Planck mass in that case. Yeah, so they give you corrections which are suppressed by this ratio of energy to Planck mass, and that's why they are small.
That's right. If you do what you say, yes, it's completely well defined.
Yeah, and may I ask one more technical question? So do you see in your approach that the couplings that you keep, the one which appears on the on-shell, that their beta functions are gauge invariants? Okay, I mean, always. Because, in general, we know that couplings may be, that beta functions may be gauge dependent, for inessential couplings. In your approach, it looks like you got rid of all inessential couplings and keep only essential ones. So it would be very nice to see that kind of, is there a place where you see that your beta functions are gauge invariant?
You mean beta function for high curvature couplings?
Or? Yeah, for high curvature couplings,
I think it's more or less obvious. For instance, look at this equation.
Mm-hmm.
It's beta function for lambda 3. It's coupling in front of Riemann, quartic power of Riemann.
Mm-hmm.
So it is expressed in terms of V13. V13 is a single pole quartic in Riemann tensor.
Okay.
And that's supposed to be invariant. The terms, counter terms, which are only due to Riemann tensor, supposed to be invariant.
So in other words, you may have some kind of recursion proof for this invariance. Yes,
yeah,
we know that.
Well,
I see.
Huh? I did not look too high, but it looks like yes, I can prove it.
Yeah, that's probably one interesting thing which can be so explicitly from your equations that you have gauge invariance of these normalized couplings.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, the next question of Tim Morris, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the interesting talk, Sergei. It looks very persuasive, but unlike in a renormalizable theory where you can prove, you can just make these reparameterizations to get rid of the infinities, here there seems to be an assumption that you've put in and you hope is correct. Is that right?
No, I don't use any assumptions. You're talking about this relation.
Well, so, but on the right-hand side, who's to say in quantum gravity that on the right-hand side you get a double pole which just fails to be reparameterized away by what you said? You haven't done, the calculations aren't done. You've just, you've made the assumption at some point.
No. I did, in the paper, I did the calculation. I actually prove it. I prove this relation.
Well, but you can't have proved it to all orders, right? Because I mean,
what about
the triple pole? Yeah, I mean, supposing you
can
triple pole explicitly at three loop.
Yes, of course.
Satisfy your relations. What would you say?
Of course, I prove it for a single pole, and it is sufficient because by recurrence relation, all higher poles are expressed in terms of single pole.
So, if you use the Tuft relations that you started with, which express the idea that ultimately you can remove all of these 1/ε poles and you get a finite theory, I would agree with you. But you're dealing here with a theory which is non-renormalizable in the usual sense. So what guarantees you that at some number of loops you get a higher order pole which simply doesn't satisfy your equations?
Okay. It's assumption that, if you like, that randomization group equations are valid here. So using these equations, I can prove that this statement which is written here. If this, if you like, is assumption that I can use Toft's randomization group equations.
Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. The next question from Alexander Wittmann. Please, Sasha.
Hi, Serge. Very, very nice talk. Very interesting, but very technical. You know, as a simple-minded guy, I am a bit puzzled. So what if we include just a lambda term from the very beginning? I think most of the parts of this construction would not work, right? Because there would appear non-zero Ricci everywhere, and it would be much, much harder. But then you could say something on cosmological constant. Have you tried to generalize it for that?
Actually, my goal is to generalize it to the case when cosmological constant is present. There might be some new features in this case.
Right.
But
because it seems that some of the even lower order terms, like exactly this statement of R cube, could get modified, right?
Well, if there is a cosmological constant, it's a new scale in the game.
Yeah.
And I should take into account, so it would be expansion both in, say, in curvature and in lambda.
Mm-hmm.
And it becomes more complicated, the whole story, because mm-hmm. there are more terms and, excuse me. There is also issue how cosmological constant is renormalized. I should write a separate equation, randomization group equation for cosmological constant. That should be added to the equations which already have here. Mm-hmm. So the story becomes more complicated, but it's more interesting, of course, than just pure quantum gravity.
Mm-hmm. Okay, looking forward. Thanks.
Okay. The last question from Andrei Barvinsky, please.
Sergei, it's really very interesting talk. And somehow you discussed a lot about renormalization of this higher order coefficients of higher order invariants in the action, but you did not say much about the relevant renormalization terms in the renormalization of the metric. So is it right that actually your statement is the following, that by renormalization of metric, you can absorb all counter terms containing any single Ricci scalar, Ricci tensor, right?
That's right. Yes.
Uh-huh. And it would seem that regarding I'm slightly returning to the question of cosmological constant. It would seem that in your previous works, you kind of more stronger statements that. Actually, if you consider include the cosmological constant from the onset, then you can actually reduce renormalization of everything in this theory just to the renormalization of the cosmological constant. And the very simple argument that you used was the following, that kind of every invariant purely gravitational theory, you can always write down as a contraction of metric with some second rank tensor composed.
That's right. Yes.
Of Riemann tensor, its covariant derivatives, whatever else. So, what does it mean that at the moment this old statement did not survive, or what is it? Can you remind?
Well. Actually, my goal is to return to this statement which you referred to, but using this randomization group approach. So my goal is to come to the same statement as in that paper, but in a more consistent way using the randomization group equations, which involves cosmological constant in the metric. So I cannot say more at this point.
Then indeed you hope that renormalization of everything would be reduced to the renormalization of just one lowest order constant, and that's it, yeah?
Well, at this point, I cannot claim this in the whole generality, but I hope to be able to address this question in the future using the serialization group approach.
Okay, good luck.
Thank you.
Okay, I guess our afternoon session is finished. Thank you to all the speakers, and we shall meet at 6 p.m. Moscow time, yes?